Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Total War, The Last Roman, and History. I'm Marcus Aurelius, and we are outside the walled city of Hadrumetum, which historically is actually not correct. When the Vandals conquered North Africa way at the beginning, they razed the walls of all settlements with the exception of the capital of Carthage, their intention being that the citizens of those settlements could not rebel against them, so it would help solidify their rule. However, it proved to be incredibly harmful to them at this time when Belisarius and his expedition landed. Now, first off, it was remarked that the term the Watchman was probably not a great name for Belisarius' army, and while, as far as I'm aware, the army didn't have a name, so any name is as good as no name, I went ahead and just renamed them the Expedition. John the Armenian is still going to be leading the group called the Brave Companions. Again, I'm not too invested in the name. Also, real quick, it is raining quite a bit outside, so I apologize if that gets through into the recording. I'm going to try to minimize it, but just giving you the heads up there. And the city looks like it's seen some better days. This is neat. Has got a little monastery here. Probably an Arian monastery, because the Vandals were Arians, and actually they tried to convert the local population to Arianism. So that was one thing that Belisarius had on his side, was that as Orthodox, the Orthodox people, the former citizens of the Roman Empire who lived in these towns, were more apt to support him. Alright, so what we need to do is choose a research path. Again, we're sticking with military. We can either get Preventores and Equites Promoti, which is okay, I guess, or we can improve our integrity. We're going to go with that instead, integrity. And quickly, what I've done is in the expedition, I have recruited some Hunnic federates. And the reason why I did that is because, in truth, in history, Belisarius had a lot of Hunnic federates in his army. Something along the lines of 600 of them, I want to say, along with 400 Heruli, which, as we discussed in the last episode, were not Huns themselves, but East Germanic warriors. In fact, one of the generals under Belisarius was a man by the name of Pharos, and he was the king of the Heruli. And anyway, so we're getting them, because they are thematic, even if in this game, missile cavalry is actually really difficult to use correctly, because the skirmish command is kind of broken. Your skirmishers tend to not run away. Even though they could outrun cavalry chasing them, they tend to stop and get attacked and die. So you have to either focus like a laser on them, or just not bring them, which is what I usually do. But again, we're trying to be thematic here. Now, this army in general is not thematic at all, because the armies of Belisarius and the armies of the Roman Empire at this period were transitioning into a cavalry-focused force. Now, Procopius goes into great detail about this. The cavalry of the Roman Empire were not only very effective with the lance and the sword, and I have to say here that I don't mean lance in the term of medieval knights, with a couched lance. Instead, they held the lance with two hands and underarm. So a little bit different in terms of battlefield deployment, but they had the lance, they had the sword, but they also had the bow, which was kind of a new thing. In fact, some of the people at the time thought that bowmen were lesser soldiers. So Procopius actually spends a lot of time in his Histories of the Wars talking about how amazing these Byzantine cavalrymen were, these bowmen, and how actually the bow is now a noble weapon used by mighty warriors to try to kind of go against that stigma. Now, against the Vandals, Procopius says the Vandals were mostly an army of heavy cavalry. He doesn't, but later historians like Hughes likens them to medieval knights in that sense. They were primarily lancers. They also had a contingent of foot archers. So against the mostly mobile, skirmishing bowmen forces of Belisarius, the poor Vandals really didn't have much of a chance. They couldn't outmaneuver them, and they were victim to a lot of the arrows. And that's one reason for the incredible success of the Roman expedition, though not the only one. And then over here, the Brave Companions, under John the Armenian, we're just getting some, whatever it is he can afford, really. We're getting some Federati cavalry and some more Federati infantry. Though, we can upgrade his muster tent to a recruiting tent, which will allow him to recruit better troops, and we're going to do that. We can also improve his marching camp to a standing camp, which lowers the integrity, unfortunately, of all expeditions, but does give us some wealth and expedition growth, which I hope means troops will heal. Now, Belisarius has a couple choices. He can improve his storehouse to either meat storage or grain storage, but both of those things lower integrity, and we're doing pretty okay in terms of food, so we're not going to really mess with that. But he has a blank spot here, and he can do a lot of things with this. He can do a public latrine, which improves integrity and growth, which is always good. Or, my next favorite is officer's tents, which improves integrity and gives us a little bit of wealth. We don't really need muster tents because we already have them, and we don't really need a workshop tent. Actually, we already have officer's tents too, never mind that. But we have market stalls. So really, the only thing that we should build that we don't already have is the public latrines, I'm pretty sure. One thing I like about Total War Warhammer is they have a screen you can go to that shows you the entire building browser for any particular settlement, in this case, a horde, where you can kind of plan out your growth. But yeah, I'm pretty sure that public latrines... Ah, there we go. They have it here too, I forgot, just right-click. So public latrines... Private latrines, very good. So, I mean, you can have multiple of the same building, of course, but I think we're going to go with the latrines just to improve integrity and growth. And that'll be that for now. We're still, our income is still good, our food is still good, so everything is all right in that respect. All right. So with this episode, I'm going to try to get started talking about the early life of Belisarius.
We will make your homes a wasteland. Despoil your women, enslave your children, and desecrate your ancestors' graves.
Okay, now this is interesting. This might be because of the hard difficulty or because of the mod, because I'm not used to the Ostrogoths declaring war on us. In fact, historically, the Ostrogoths were very neutral in this conflict. In fact, the Roman expedition under Belisarius actually stopped for a minute to refuel and rest in Sicily, which was under Ostrogothic rule, and they allowed this on their way to the Vandals in North Africa. So this is going to prove quite a challenge for us. I don't think the Ostrogoths really are going to have an ability to get close to us. They're pretty far away, but still, it's going to make things a little bit more difficult. And of course, we're being joined by the Roman Empire, of which we are a part. So Belisarius was born in a town called Germana in what is now Western Bulgaria. It was kind of on the border of the province of Illyricum and the province of Thrace, though he's remarked many times as being a Thracian, similar to Justinian. He was likely born between 500 and 505 AD. We don't know exactly when he was born. Alright, so let's take a look here. We have a spy. So, Carthage is currently being garrisoned by a pretty mighty force led by the heir, Amytas. Amytas, okay. But the new king of the Vandals, since we killed their previous king, is Tezazo, and he's got actually kind of a weak force here outside of Hippo Diarrhea and Hippo Diarrhoetus, of course. And there's another force guarding that city as well. I am a shadow. And that appears to really be the only Vandal forces in the area, so we should probably make for Thuburbo, and then, well, I think we should keep our forces together. We can take Bularegia and the Gaste later. But we should probably go north, just like Belisarius did, and make a beeline for Carthage itself. We could take these armies as long as we're combined. We hunger for battle. I don't think we need forced march. No, we certainly don't. Okay. So let's scout it out with John here. Advance. Ready for battle. So he can't quite make it. Would that I were a... That's okay. And let's get Belisarius up here to help him. And both of you now go into your encampment stance. At your command. And we're still in the middle of stuff, so there's really not much we can do here. Now, the cool thing about this is that while we are a horde, the Roman Empire will send armies to defend these cities. So pretty soon, we're going to see allied, affiliated Roman armies just marching around, minding their own business, defending their own cities. So we don't have to really worry about that. And it looks like the Ostrogoths also declared war on the Burgundians, which is good because it'll distract their attention. I am yours to Now, I can use Lucinus here, offensively. Like, I can do something to one of these armies, slow him down, and that's good to get him experience, but he may die as a result, and we lose his abilities as a scout, so I'm a little nervous about it, but not nervous enough to not do it. So let's go say hi to the new king. We could hinder his army. We only have a 17% chance of losing our hero. Well, he's not really a hero, our agent. But we have a 50% chance of him actually getting some experience. So let's do it. And of course, the 17% chance that he suffers a critical failure took place. And we have now lost our scout, which is normally a very bad thing. But considering I don't see a lot of Vandal activity going on around here, I think we're going to be okay. Just this once. So, while no one knows for sure anything really about Belisarius' early life, it can be assumed, based on a few things, that he was from a noble family. Now, the reason why it can be assumed this, and Ian Hughes goes into this, is because Procopius spends a lot of time in his Anecdota, or secret history, bad-mouthing Justinian and Theodora because they were essentially peasants that have been risen up. But he doesn't say the same things about Belisarius, and you'd think that he would if Belisarius was a lower-class citizen. So it's posited that Belisarius is probably a decurion rank, which basically is like a city leader, and that also is shown in his rapid advancement in the army, which obviously normal people wouldn't be expected to do. But we are being attacked here by a humongous force of Vandals, like pretty much everyone. They brought the house against us. So about, oh boy, almost 5,000 Vandal troops against our almost 5,000 Roman troops. We could retreat from this. That is a possibility. But I say, let the die be cast, right? Let's go. So, as I mentioned, Belisarius rose up in the military quite rapidly, which is very unusual for the period, and it could be due to a number of reasons. Obviously, either he was incredibly talented, he was incredibly well-connected, or a third chance was that his personality, which we find out a lot in the stuff written about him, he was an honest guy, he was reliable, and that may have helped him quite a bit. Possibly a combination of all those things. Now, our battlefield is completely flat. This is terrible. We're going to have to just count on Roman might to save the day. Now, luckily for us, our reinforcements are coming in behind us, not like way across the battlefield or something like that. So let's see, what are we going to do here? Now, again, historically, the army would have been composed of mostly cavalry, and they would have been in the front. And they would, you know, charge, shoot their bows, whatever. But obviously, cavalry is a very small component of our military in this game. So what I'm going to do is we're going to have our front with our just regular Federati swordsmen. We're going to have our spearmen on the flanks. And our kind of elite infantry will be behind. They can come in whenever needed. And this is not how the actual battle line is going to look. This is just how I'm setting them up. I'm going to move back a little bit. Our archers can be here in the middle for right now. And our cavalry can be here off to the side. Belisarius, of course, is going to kind of hang back. We don't want to lose him. And the Exploradores, you know, I'm not a big fan of these guys. I didn't use them much in my Attila campaign. They're decent swordsmen, but they're really more like irregulars, I guess you'd say. They have good capture power, which is great, I guess, if you're attacking a city. But it does say here they have excellent armor. So, who knows? Alright. So first thing I want to do, I'm going to pause the battle real quick. And I want to actually fix these lines up a little bit. Cheap, though it may be, I think I want to use the borders of the map to my advantage here. Let's get these guys down like this. Then we'll have our swordsmen kind of like this. And then our final two cavalry, or not cavalry, I'm sorry, spearmen, like this. All right. And then we can kind of fill the gaps with our troops that are coming in. So behind them, I'm going to want our archers. Let's get them as spread out as possible. There we go. And I think in the last Roman, the archers are a bit more effective in terms of being able to shoot over your troops and not killing them, not shooting them in the back, though they're still nowhere near as good at this as they are in Total War Warhammer, where archers actually can fire from behind their own troops without murdering all of them. Okay, and our two units of elites we're going to keep kind of in reserve here. All right, excellent. Our exploratores we will also keep in reserve, why not? And our cavalry. I love how they start us off with scout equites, which from a gameplay perspective I guess is fair, but in reality it's kind of lame. Actually, you know what? Let's have our Huns out there. We have cataphracts, which by this period of time the Roman army was really moving away from really super heavily armed cavalry. Again, they're focused mostly on the ranged cavalry, and they were armed and armored, but the horses didn't really have barding in the idea that we know of, like cataphracts. So let's take a look. Let's take a look at our troops, and here come our reserves.
Enemy reinforcements have arrived.
So these are our voluntaries. These are added by the mod, and they do look pretty cool. I like their little bucket helms here, which is probably felt. At the time, it was felt, so not incredibly... I mean, they're probably maybe metal underneath there. Some of these guys have, obviously, metal helmets. So then we have our basic limitane, which look very similar to the ones we had in the Attila campaign. Our federate are just higher armored versions, but I don't like how it looks like they're basically just wearing cloth and no armor. That really kind of bugs me, so I'm glad about this mod. It kind of adds armored troops. More federati. Even more federati. And I just like the diversity, too. I don't want an army with, like, 15 federati units. Oh, I didn't move Belisarius, though. That was real smart of me. Let's set him up here. But let's look at his troops, though. As you can see, the horses don't have barding or armor of any kind. And this is his elite Bucellarii guard, so you kind of get a feel for how they were abandoning that form of arm at that time. All right, and here are our... This must be our reserves here. Wow, okay, let's slow things down just so we can integrate them more effectively into our army here, because this is starting to get a little out of control. John, of course, we're going to keep back. I think having a backup unit of spearmen, especially in this area, is probably a good idea. I have a whole nother set of cavalry. But again, scout equites is not very useful cavalry. I guess these guys go here for now. We do have another unit of bowmen, which is great. Actually, two units of bowmen. You know what? Let's reform all of our bowmen. Oh. Well, whoops. Let's, I want them in a group, but I don't want them locked. I want to be able to command them. All right. We're ungrouping you. Sorry. There we go. I like grouping them, though, because you can direct their fire. Okay, Belisarius, let's get you back here. Actually, more like here, since John's to the to that flank. Alright, so as I mentioned, the Vandal army of the period was mostly heavy cavalry. That's what we would consider it. More spearmen? Flame in heck, we have a lot of spearmen. So let's take a look at them, huh? So we've got hurlers, slingers, I guess. So yeah, that fits. That fits what's been said, that their foot infantry, for the most part, was very weak and mostly ranged. Moorish levy. Okay, I'll buy that. Now, I don't think they would necessarily have mercenary Germanic pikes, but whatever. Germanic band. This, again, is also... I mean, I'm not saying they don't have this, but it wasn't the real highlight of their army. There were actually relatively few Vandals compared to the native populations. So they wouldn't really waste themselves on infantry. They would focus mostly on training their cavalry, and they had plenty of pasture land for horses, so again, that's another sign. I guess legionary defectors, sure. They didn't, from what I understand, have any, but okay, that'll be fun. Make the battle a bit more challenging. More Moorish levies. Germanic spearmen? Eh, it's possible. So basically, it's like mostly a Moorish force, honestly. More slingers, Germanic band. I'm trying to find... Okay, Vandal horsemen. Okay. Okay, they're wearing chainmail. They have shields. Spears. I'll have to look up whether or not they had spears or if they were sword wielders. Of course, here's the here's their leader, the Vandali Comitatus. So these are the heavy Vandal cavalry. They seem about right to me. So you would expect that most of the Vandals would look kind of like this. Mail armored, shielded, sword wielding. I'll have to check on the spear presence, but let's stop going at low speed. All right, Huns. Let's actually look at our Huns. We haven't really seen them. They look cool. Now, even though by this period, the regular cavalry of the Roman Empire was trained in the same way as the Hunnic steppe nomadic cavalry, they still were incredibly valuable because they were still better. Even though the army has taken great pains to train themselves to fight like the Huns were still better at it. They were still the masters of it. Also, the Huns used a particular type of bow that was not symmetrical. It was actually shorter on the bottom than on the top. That had not yet taken hold onto the native Roman troops. Okay, so we gotta be careful here, because they are leading with their ranged troops, and obviously our Huns aren't gonna hold up well against that. Probably be smart for us just to... I don't like having our cavalry just out here. You know what? Real quick, let's just... These four units of spearmen that are just kind of sitting here, let's have them extend our line like that, and then we'll put our cavalry behind them, kind of in a position of safety. And let's, there we go, let's change the angle a little bit so we can see a bit better. And go. We'll keep the Huns outside of our defensive line for now because they're skirmisher cav. And the swordsmen, I guess, here. I mean, we're certainly not lacking troops here. And our troops should be much more elite than the Vandal troops. So like Justinian, the Emperor Justinian, Belisarius was a native Thracian and Latin speaker. So this is kind of an idea as to why he was liked so much by Justinian, because Justinian mostly was surrounded by older men who were Greek speakers. Those were the generals and leaders of the empire at the time. So to find this young man, roughly the same age as him, who was from his native region, spoke his native languages, that obviously could have played a role in Belisarius' rapid rise. It took Belisarius only 10 years to go from just signing up with the army to being in the bodyguard of Justinian. And that's actually kind of interesting because I've seen in other sources where they mention that he was a bodyguard of Justin, the Emperor Justin, Justinian's uncle. But I've looked through all my sources, and Hughes, Mahon, they all agree that he was actually a bodyguard of Justinian, even before Justinian was an emperor. So when Justinian was just the magister utriesque militae, basically the chief executive of the military. All right, Huns, I don't like this. They're kind of charging out. Let's pull them back, and they can kind of charge out when necessary. Ooh, let's also give them their good Alright. So quickly here, let's just... I think our guys have... Yeah, they have Testudo formation. Why not use it? Oops. I guess these guys, the Voluntari, don't have it. Well, that's one thing kind of going against them. They have better stats, but without the Testudo, they're going to take a bit more hits on defense. Wow, this is going to determine basically if we can proceed with this campaign in North Africa or if we die, essentially. All right, so first off, our archers, let's go with a heavy shot and try to get rid of these Vandal horsemen.
They are trying to take out our general. Defend him.
He'll be fine. All right, battle is engaged. Whoa. They just kind of split up there. That was really weird. All right. Can we reach their general? Not quite. Oh, they're breaking through here. Let's send up some reinforcements to help in that area. Actually, let's commit these guys as well. Let's move them up here and up here.
The men have thrown down their weapons and are fleeing.
Who is? Federati. Let's see if we can break through right here. Oh, these guys. Okay. Yeah, they just took a cavalry charge. What do you expect? Alright, Belisarius, do you have any abilities here? You do. Excellent. Let's scare these guys. And let's scare them even more. John, what do you do?
As you command, our men return to the fight.
Okay, good. These guys are a little bit out of their league there, but they're fighting against... Well, they are fighting against spearmen. All right, swordsmen, let's get over there, please. I want to find a space where we can break our cavalry through. Dang it. Our infantry are not performing up to expectations here. Oh, excellent. That was really great. I hadn't hoped for that. There you go. All right, enough of this. Let's just do the best we can. We're going to try to break through here. They have swordsmen and axemen. And their general, who should be low morale. Let's just try to press our way through. Also, they have cavalry here.
Enemy units have returned to the battle.
Swordsmen, get up there. Okay. John's being attacked. There's our Huns. Let's actually break through the line here. It seems like we're doing all right. I thought our cavalry was going to be enough to break through here, but they're not. They're not supposed to be in melee combat. The Vandals are doing a pretty good job of charging at us. We seem to be doing well here, though. Let's move these guys up real quick and move them over here. And then this flank will be cleared. Oh, but there are axes here.
Men are broken and are fleeing.
Obviously, we're not going to charge cavalry headline on the pikemen, but they seem to be wavering. How about right about there? Dang it, they made it through. Alright, so this section is now under control for the most part. We do have to worry about their range troops, so if we move our infantry up here, we need to get our cavalry free. Right now they're the only thing holding this line up here, so I don't want to... Let's get Belisarius over there. Alright, now we're seeing some movement. Let's see. Alright, enough of this. Let's get our Huns to charge them. And we're going to get John as well. Ooh, shoot. They have some infantry there. Let's weave John through. There we go. Okay, let's get these guys up here. No. Alright, now we'll move them over here. And let's get these spearmen from behind. There we go. Alright. And now our cavalry are free to run around and do cavalry things, like chasing down enemies and attacking ranged units. In fact, let's go up to these guys. And now we can do some hammer and anvil. Oh, just the presence of the cavalry behind their lines was enough to send them running. And now these guys are free. Alright, Huns, don't shoot arrows at them. Let's just run them down, huh? For me. Come on. Alright, well, we've done it. It was tense there for a minute. Our cavalry had to kind of hold the line, which is not what cavalry's supposed to do. But because this is such a pivotal battle, we can't just sit here and let them get away. We need to take out as many of them as we possibly can. Come on, Huns. Let's get you out of that mode. Let's get you into loose formation and just have you start running people down. These planes aren't that different from the steppes of your birth. Who do we got there? Is that Belisarius? Oh, wow. Ah, traffic! No, it's John. Hope we can speed things up a bit here, just while we're cleaning up. I love how some of our troops are still wavering. The battle's over. All we're doing is chasing down survivors, and they're still scared. I think you guys are out of danger, honestly. Don't think you have to be worried. They must be crushed. And we're doing a pretty good job of that. Let's follow good old Flavius here. Can't tell right off the bat which one is him. Maybe the guy on the white horse? No. Oh, maybe the guy with the orange. No, there's multiple guys with orange. Oh, well, anyway. We've done it. Oh, no, we don't want to do that. All right, ladies and gentlemen, what happened here? We lost nearly the entirety of our force. We actually lost about 3,000. We have 2,000 remaining. A Pyrrhic victory. But the Vandals only have 928 remaining. We have 2,000. We are going to take on warriors. Ready for orders. And that will be it for this episode. Super long 35-minute episode, so this is gonna be heck to encode. But anyways, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoyed this. Next episode, we'll speak more on Belisarius. Now that we're done with his early life, we'll start going into where he next shows up in the history, which is the Persian Wars. So once again, I'm Marcus Aurelius. I'd like to thank you very much for watching Total War, The Last Roman, and History. Have a good one.